What's up, you beautiful bastards? Hope you have a fantastic Tuesday. Welcome back to the Philip DeFranco Show, and let's just jump into it. And the first thing we're going to talk about today is why we had Iggy Azalea in the news. So if you didn't hear, and obviously we're not going to show them here, Iggy Azalea had nude photographs leaked, specifically topless photographs. And when most people hear leaked, they think, okay, like someone's iCloud was compromised, or it's like some sort of selfie photo, but this actually dealt with unpublished professional photographs. And specifically, the photos were from a 2016 Woman of the Year GQ photo shoot. And the photos were reportedly taken by Nino Munoz. So these leak, and then the next thing we see is that Iggy deactivates her Twitter and Instagram with these massive followings. There's a lot of questions in the air, what the hell is happening? And she ends up coming back very briefly to issue a statement, and in it she explains, recently some outtakes from my 2016 GQ magazine cover were leaked to the public. A lot of high profile women have shot covers for GQ with a strategically placed hand, etc., covering their breasts, etc. I always felt they were very beautiful covers, so I jumped at the opportunity. Adding, I hadn't seen other women's covers leak, so I felt comfortable on a closed set to model for such a reputable magazine, knowing only the images with my hands covering would be considered for print. And really hitting the point, I never consented to taking topless pictures for potential release, period. It was my understanding before shooting, GQ do not print topless pictures. There was no reason for anyone to have kept the outtakes from the shoot. I'm surprised and angry that they were not immediately deleted after the final images were selected. I feel blindsided, embarrassed, violated, angry, sad, and a million other things. Not solely because I did not consent to this, but also because of the vile way people have reacted. Further explaining that point, a lot of the comments I see from men in particular taking things even further and sharing their thoughts and fantasies in regards to my body has honestly disturbed me. The outright wicked things people say is overwhelming and makes me feel like throwing up. Then regarding the legal aspect of this, she said, I fully intended on finding out where the leak originated from and pressing criminal charges in regards to this. It's important to me that someone actually be held accountable for their actions and the way it impacts my life. And as far as why she deactivated her social accounts, I don't feel there is anywhere I can retreat to or that I have a happy place I can wait in until it all blows over. Please think of how you might feel if the shoe was yours to wear. I have seen some really vicious shit written in the last 24 hours, and it is too much negativity for me to handle. For now, it's best to keep my accounts deactivated. Please be kinder to one another. And what I'll say in regards to this story, for me personally, this was a kind of a standout story because it created this interesting snapshot of social behavior, right? Because it feels like ever since 2014, right, whether you call it Celebgate or The Fappening, where there were all those nude photographs of celebrities just out there. Following a lot of that, it's felt like the general public has been a lot more sympathetic for people that have their stuff leaked. But there are also times where that's not the case. And this is a little oversimplified because there are other reasons why people would be less sympathetic, but it feels like as long as that person looks good, a good number of people seem to throw consent to show this to the general public out the window, and they go, well, what do they have to be sad about? They look great. Obviously, a different situation, I would argue a worse situation. In the past, we've seen instances like that of Justin Bieber, who there was a photo he obviously did not consent to. I can't even imagine the zoom lens that was required to take this photo.
It just looks like the photo was taken from so far away. He's naked. He seems like he thinks that he's in private. And obviously, he didn't consent to the photo being released. But because those photos didn't showcase anything that some people would call inadequate, people were like, well, this is just good PR for him. Lucky him. But he obviously didn't consent to that. And same thing to this Iggy Azalea situation, although obviously there are certain pieces that are different. She obviously consented to the photo shoot for the photos being taken, but she said she didn't consent for this release. And that's a thing that needs to be considered. But when you search Iggy Azalea on places like Twitter, it's like, it's just kind of page after page of memes and, oh yeah, I'm gonna jerk off to that. And hitting on that note of people being less sympathetic because someone looks good, I mean, you also found examples of that, right? Tweets like, why is she mad? She looks amazing. And understand, I share this opinion not to be high and mighty and to look down and judge onto all the others. I say this as someone that did not always have this opinion. I say this as someone that definitely was not as sympathetic in the past. And I also wonder if people are less sympathetic because we've kind of been trained to think that everything is fake or a publicity stunt, which obviously enough of that and your perception of reality, especially when it comes to people who, once again, celebrities are real people, but they often seem like characters because we've never met them. People kind of more than ever are easier to be perceived as entertainment to be consumed and less than a person. I don't know, but I am interested to learn about the details of this story. Like, how did these photos get out? According to the photographer, the photos were stolen and published without his permission. But also at the same time, I do want to note that there is a genuine question as far as who actually had the photograph. And I say that because as I was researching this story, I came across something that actually happened back in 2016. Iggy says she's angry because the photos were not immediately deleted after the final images were selected. But it appears that possibly there was another version of these photos out there. Because in December of 2016, her plastic surgeon posted a video that includes this signed photo with a nudity covered by emoji. And I'm not sharing this because I'm like, aha, it was Iggy or the plastic surgeon. I'm just saying that a larger group of people may have been in possession or had the ability to get the possession of these photos. And the more people that get involved, the more people that might leak something, or the more people that have a vulnerability where they're in information or these photos could be accessed by a third party.
But yeah,
that's where we are for now. It's going to be interesting to see if any other information comes up, if anyone starts pointing fingers.
Yeah.
We'll have to wait to see. And of course, with this whole story, I'd love to know any and all of your thoughts.
But from that, I want to share some stuff I love today and today and awesome, brought to you by Beautiful Bastard and BeautifulBastard.com. And for those that don't know, Beautiful Bastard is my premium hair care line, right? We launched with high quality pomades, beard oils. It smells so damn good. We turn some into candles. You've maybe, if you watch me on desktop or mobile, seen that little carousel of products underneath each video. In general, it's all about the four goods. Look good, smell good, feel good, and do good. And that's why we use fantastic quality ingredients that are ethically sourced, cruelty free. It is all handmade in the United States. And until the end of next month, 10% of all sales go to St. Jude. And today, because Father's Day is coming up, I wanted to launch another Beautiful Bastard challenge. If you or someone you know is like me, you tried for so long to find something for your hair, it seemed impossible. Sometimes it would dry it out, it would get flaky, or it'd be like damp and limp, and just, or it just wouldn't hold all day. And for the follicle gifted out there, maybe your beard is kind of like dusty, flaky, dry, not great. I challenge you today to try some of our good, and to help you over that first time hurdle, for the next 48 hours, I will be taking 20% off if you use code BBC2. Try it out for yourself or make it the perfect Father's Day gift. Ties for Father's Day is a bullshit gift, and I'll stand by that until I finally launch my own set of ties. Main point, take the challenge, go to beautifulbastard.com, use code BBC2 to get 20% off. And of course, as always, remember, it is first come, first served. It is a handmade product, so there are limitations. And the first bit of awesome is we had John Hamm and my doctor answering the web's most searched questions. We got the full trailer for Swamp Thing. Then we got the tease/date announcement for the Marvel Netflix series that has not been canceled yet, Jessica Jones season 3. Netflix gave us Kanye West styling David Letterman. Trevor Wallace gave us When Your Name Is Kyle. If your eyes are craving Calora Creations, Binging with Babish gave us Orange Mocha Frappuccinos from Zoolander. And if you want to see the full versions of everything I just shared, the secret link of the day, really anything at all, links as always are in the description down below. And then let's talk about this kind of slowly increasing in size boycott that we're seeing in Georgia. As we talked about previously on the show, Georgia passed a fetal heartbeat abortion ban, which experts say if this was fully put into place, it would ban abortions as early as 6 weeks. And following this, there were obviously massive reactions on both sides, but something that we've been seeing growing and growing is how the filming industry is responding. You know, we've seen individuals responding like Kristen Wiig, Jason Bateman, David Simon, Mark Duplass, some already pulling what they're filming from Georgia, others saying if this goes through the court system or this goes into effect next January, we're gonna boycott it. We also saw Jordan Peele and J.J. Abrams publicly deciding to donate money from their show that'll start filming in Georgia soon. Specifically, their production company is releasing a joint statement saying, "We stand with Stacey Abrams and the hardworking people of Georgia, and will donate 100% of our respective episodic fees for this season to two organizations leading the charge against this draconian law, the ACLU of Georgia and Fair Fight Georgia." You know, these are individuals, no kind of major institution. But now we've heard from Netflix's chief content officer, Ted Sarandos. And he responded, "We have many women working on productions in Georgia whose rights, along with millions of others, will be severely restricted by this law. It's why we will work with the ACLU and others to fight it in court. Given the legislation has not yet been implemented, we'll continue to film there while also supporting partners and artists who choose not to. Should it ever come into effect, we'd rethink our entire investment in Georgia." And while this is still obviously early on, this is a massive statement from a massive organization, and it potentially shows us where this industry might trend. And depending on how many other individuals and studios follow suit, I mean, this could have a crazy economic impact. According to Variety, last year, Georgia reported some 92,000 jobs and an economic impact of more than $9 billion from production. But there's also the question of, do these studios want to risk losing their 30% tax rebate? And actually, on that note, it's not completely out of the question to imagine that there are going to be other states that start advertising as an alternative. Like, obviously, there are other states that are trying to bring people in for production, but I mean specifically angled around this. But also, there's this debate of kind of people saying that they will boycott it once something actually gets put into place. Is that kind of just empty words? Right, especially when you compare it to individuals that are already pulling productions, or they're saying they're going to donate some of the money they make. I don't know, you can kind of say that it's empty, but I mean, even making that statement, it's going to be alienating, obviously, to part of their audience. Right, so even saying that, they're publicly taking a side. And in general, large businesses probably don't want to be a part of the abortion debate, capital punishment, the Second Amendment. Now, as far as if this ban will be effective, my personal opinion is no. Given how polarizing the situation is and what was passed in Georgia was so strict, since experts say most people don't even know that they're pregnant at 6 weeks, this isn't something the lawmakers or the people that support this bill are going to back down from. But I could be wrong, and I'm aware of that as someone that constantly says most all of everything comes down to money. And if you want to get people to go a certain way, you hit them in the wallet. I just
I think that this is too polarizing of an issue.
But, of course, with that said, as always, I'd love to pass the question off to you. What are your thoughts on this? Then let's talk about this crazy situation happening at Mount Everest. Right now, Mount Everest, which I randomly found out, according to Google reviews, only is worth 4.2 stars, it currently has an overcrowding problem. And the thing is, when you have an overcrowding problem that happens on a mountain that is 29,000 feet above sea level, the consequences can be catastrophic. And so that's exactly what we're seeing this climbing season. In the past 2 weeks, 11 people, including two Americans, have died on Everest, which is insane when you compare it to last year's total of just 5. And when you hear about people dying on Mount Everest, right, you think it's caused by the weather, other conditions, mistakes. But expert climbers are saying that a big factor this year is that there are just too many people on the mountain. Reportedly, last week on Wednesday, more than 200 climbers and their guides tried to reach the summit of Mount Everest and caused a traffic jam leading to the peak. And to really paint this picture for you, the peak is above 29,000 feet, and the flat part is about the size of two ping pong tables. And reports say that around 15 or 20 people at a time were packed up there trying to document their climb with a picture of themselves at the top. And in this photo that went viral last week, you can see these long lines of just climbers waiting for their chance to get to the top. And according to a liaison officer at the Everest Base Camp, climbers were complaining of waiting at least 2 hours at bottlenecks on their way to the top. And according to a handful of Sherpas, some of the deaths this year were caused by people getting held up in the long lines on the last 1,000 feet or so of the climb, unable to get up and down fast enough to replenish their oxygen supply. You had mountain guide Adrian Ballinger saying, "Humans just really aren't meant to exist there. Even when using bottled oxygen, supplemental oxygen, there's only a very few number of hours that we can actually survive up there before our bodies start to shut down." Now, following this news coming out, there's been a lot of criticism about Nepal, because in the 2019 climbing season alone, the Department of Tourism in Nepal approved a record number of permits for over 380 individuals so they could climb Everest. And when you include the climbing guides and the Sherpas that those people need to make it to the summit, the Department of Tourism estimates that the total number of ascents could reach 1,000. And a really interesting note here, and this is surprising to me, some sources are saying you just need a doctor's note to get a permit. And many climbers and guides are saying that climbers with less experience, along with increased commercialization, it's really creating a dangerous situation that the government seems unmotivated to change. And that's because the permit alone is $11,000, and it's just the beginning of the payments required. You know, a Sherpa or a guide will put you back another $5,000, maintenance fees for the campsites are another $2,000. That's why, according to a former climbing guide who was speaking with the New York Times, this is not going to improve. There's a lot of corruption in the Nepali government, adding they take whatever they can get. That said, on the other side of this, we've heard from the general director of the country's Department of Tourism. He's spoken out and denied that the increase in permits has led to more deaths, calling it a baseless suggestion, explaining that, quote, "The main cause of deaths on Everest has been high altitude sickness, which is what happened with most of the climbers who lost their lives this season as well." And then seemingly finishing his statement with the equivalent of, "I guess I'll just turn this car around," saying, "If you really want to limit the number of climbers, let's just end all expeditions on our holy mountain." And upon seeing that statement, it will probably not shock you that Nepal's government has said that they will not be changing the rules or restrictions on the number of permits for next year. And as far as my personal reaction to this story, it's hard for me not to somewhat blame the Nepal government. I understand that it can be hard to sympathize with people that put themselves in a life-threatening situation. Right? It's an elective activity that has historically killed over 300 people. Hell, in 2014, 2015, there were 17 and then 19 deaths, although that was due to avalanches. In 2012, there are conflicting reports, but at least 10 people died, and the increase was once again connected to overcrowding. But if you're the one issuing permits for people to do the thing, it seems like you're somewhat responsible. You're issuing more permits than ever to people that don't even have to prove they can handle it. You literally have to just bring a doctor's note. Especially because you have that general director saying, well, you know, it's high altitude sickness. You know, essentially being like, yeah, you know, it's part of the thing. What can you do? Well, seemingly not issue as many permits so people aren't going up there at the same time and getting stuck in 2 hour lines in areas described by mountain climbers as the death zone. These aren't people stuck in line at Starbucks. You're talking about people over, I think it's 26,000 and some change feet. They're in the death zone. Look at how narrow it is. It's not like a question of, well, if they got scared, why don't they go down? They're getting stuck. And when you're talking about a situation where minutes matter and you have people saying that the whole thing should take them 12 hours, but it's taking them 17, you are permitting the situation to be as dangerous as it's getting. And obviously, I'm not saying that you completely wipe away personal responsibility of inserting yourself into this already understood dangerous situation. But for the government officials to be so dismissive of it, a situation that it seems like is in their best interest to make safer, it's so odd. But ultimately, that's the story as it is right now. It's going to be interesting to see if we're going to see these numbers rise, what else we're going to see come out of this. But of course, like with everything, I'd love to know your thoughts on this. And that's where we're going to end today's show. And remember, if you like this video, let us know. Just take a second to hit that like button. If you want more in the future, be sure to hit that subscribe button. Also, if you're not 100% filled in, maybe you missed one of the last two Philip DeFranco shows, you can click or tap right there to watch those. But with that said, of course, as always, my name's Philip DeFranco. You've just been filled in. I love yo faces, and I'll see you tomorrow.